playing, and how much is the church world? How much are you and I just like people today?
Amen.
Therefore, let's see. And the Lord, in verse number 6, the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he may take away the serpents from us." And Moses prayed for the people. What a man of God. And the Lord said unto Moses, "Make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass, and every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live." And Moses made a serpent of brass, and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. Now I'm going to read two more portions of Scripture. You don't have to turn there. Just remain standing for just a minute more. And John chapter 3 and verse 14, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of God be lifted up." And John chapter 12 and verse 27, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I unto this hour. Father, glorify my name." Then came there a voice from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." The people thereof that stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said it was an angel spoke to him. And Jesus answered and said, "This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out." And he said in verse number 32, "And if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me." Father God, in the lovely name of Jesus, we come before you as humble as we know how. God, I lay myself at your feet as an humble servant. God, I pray that you would use me. Oh, praise God for your presence. God, I pray that you would use me to speak to this great people. God, people that this video will go out and touch, Lord. I pray that you would use the words, Lord. Use this vessel, God, and I'll be careful to praise you. Anoint the words that I speak, God. Anoint the hearts of the listener that we might take it in and live by it. And we'll be careful to thank you for it. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and may God richly bless you and bless the reading of his word. There's a pandemic in this land, and it's not a pandemic of the swine flu. It's not even a pandemic of the COVID-19, but it's a pandemic that has been affecting man since the very beginning of time. A pandemic is a global outbreak of disease. Pandemics happen when new viruses emerge to infect people and can be spread between people sustainably because there's little or no pre-existing immunity against this new virus, and it spreads worldwide. Amen. There was a pandemic started back at the very beginning of time. Amen. Back before, amen, I believe, probably before the world was created, when Satan, amen, fell from heaven, praise God. He was cast down to the earth. That pandemic I'm talking about this morning is the pandemic of sin. And a moral act considered to be a transgression against the divine law. Amen. Against God's law. Amen. And I'm here to tell you that in the beginning, sin had no cure. Amen. But our animals were slaughtered by the billions through the years only to stack up the sins of the people from one year to the other. That priest, amen, would go up there and cut the throat of that animal. The blood would be poured out, and the blood would be saved and used for different things. Amen. Billions upon top of billions of animals were slaughtered. Amen. Only to have our sins stacked up and piled up. It was almost like they were piled up into a corner. Amen. They were forgiven us, but they were still hanging back there. But I'm glad one day, praise God, there was a lamb slain. Amen. The Bible said, from the foundation of the world. Amen. And that blood, amen, forever washed away man's sin. From the very beginning of time, God began to devise a plan. Amen. That man would be made whole, praise God, and be forgiven of that sin. Oh, amen. How many times did Israel backslide? How many times did they commit idolatry and spiritual adultery? Oh, how many times did Israel sin by questioning God? and charging God foolishly. The Bible said they're talking about Job, said Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly when he went through his trouble. But Israel, every time they got a chance, they cried. Over 400 years, God send us a deliverer. God send us a way out. And God brought up that little boy Moses in Pharaoh's house, and he stayed there until the time when he saw God needed a deliverer, and he went out and helped deliver the children of Israel. They wandered through the wilderness, amen. Sometimes we've got to wander through the wilderness for God to get our attention.
Yeah.
I like the old saying, the fellow said one time, it took God 40 days to get God to get the children of Israel out of Egypt. 40 years, rather. But it took them 40 days to get Israel out of Egypt. It took them 40 years to get Egypt out of Israel. Praise God. Amen. The Bible said, woe unto them that go back to Egypt for their help. How many times did Israel sin by charging God and the man of God foolishly? Amen. If our pastor here this morning is like any other pastor around the United States of America that has any weight about him, any grain of salt about him, he's been misaccused, he's been charged, he's had people leave mad, come back happy, leave mad again. Amen. And if they're not careful, we have to be careful how we treat the man of God, because if we do wrong by him, God will hold us guilty. Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, we are living in a time, amen, that this assembly is looked down on. What if you get the virus? If you get the virus, I mean, you could go to the grocery store and get the virus.
Amen.
Amen. They're trying to shut the church down, but they're allowed by Planned Parenthood to run wide open. Amen. They're trying to shut the church down, but they've got drive-through restaurants open right now, drive-in restaurants that you can go and order. They're trying to shut the restaurant down. They've got drive-through liquor stores that they haven't bothered to shut down. Amen. This is an essential business right here. It's an essential place, amen, to be in the house of God and to have the worship of the Lord. Amen. To be able to worship the Lord. Hey, in the beginning there was no cure. Oh, but God. Amen. I read one time where the Bible talks about the scapegoat and how that the priest would go out and he would lay his hand upon the goat and he would confess the sins of the people of Israel. He would confess them, and then a young man would lead that goat way out in the wilderness. Amen. A young fit man, not an old fat man like me. Amen. That couldn't hardly run across the street without giving out a breath. That young man ran miles and miles, amen, out into the wilderness to put that goat out there. Amen. And leave it there, and the sins of Israel would be taken away. Oh, but you know what? One time I preached, praise God, that goat, sometimes, amen, there's folks that will lay their hands on that goat and take it out of the wilderness, and they've got a leash on it, amen, tethered to it, and they'll run back to town, and they'll run it back with that goat right behind them. I preached a message one time called, "You Better Turn That Goat Loose." And if I should tell the church or America anything this morning, my thought is, you better turn that goat loose, America. You better forsake your sins and turn back to God. I preached the last time I was here that if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven. Amen. As long as there's sin in the camp. You see what happened right here. God gave, amen, the Israelites the victory over Canaan. The next thing you know, they're turned around and grumbling and complaining and murmuring against God. And then God sent the fiery serpents out to bite them. And the next thing you know, they're crying out to Moses, "Call out to God for us. Amen. Pray for us that we'll be healed." And amen, God gave a remedy. He told Moses, "Make you a brazen serpent and put it on the pole. And every man and woman and child that looks at the serpent will be healed." Amen. Praise. Even while they were being bit, amen, all they had to do was look up at that serpent, a serpent, amen, and God would heal them.
Amen.
Amen. The title of my message this morning is a simple thought. That's what happened the other morning when I woke up, my foot hurt. I woke up and God spoke to me and said, "Look and live. Look and live.
Right.
There was a young lady messaged me the day before that, told me to pray for her cousin. Amen, that she was contemplating suicide. Oh God, how many, how much trouble, amen, is in America. Folks are at their deepest despair. The spirit of depression is all over the place. Folks taking medicine left and right. Amen for depression. I take a medicine. Used to take a medicine called Cymbalta. Amen. And 20 milligrams, 40 milligrams. It's good for, amen, neuropathy in your feet and legs. But when you get on up there in those big doses, amen, that's what they take for depression. It makes you all happy and all giddy. Amen. They're living in such distraught times in their minds. I was reading up last night and I began to look at some statistics. Amen. The Center for Disease Control talked about suicide. Suicide is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States for all ages. Amen. And for certain ages, it's the number one cause of death. Every day, approximately 123 Americans die by suicide. There's one death by suicide in the United States every 12 minutes. Amen. I don't know how many minutes have passed since we started this service. Amen. But there's been multitudes step. Amen. In that valley of decision, the writer said decisions, decisions, multitudes in the valley of decision. They're getting ready to cross the line. Amen. That they don't know what's on the other side. They're thinking the devil has them convinced. I'd be better off if I'm dead. Friend of mine, listen to me. What's on the other side of that bullet? What's on the other side of that pill? What's on the other side of that car wreck is not going to be pleasant. Amen. Don't do it. Oh, the depression affects 20 to 25% of Americans ages 18 in a given year. It takes, amen, the lives of over 44,965 Americans every year. In 2018, there were 48,344 recorded suicides, up from 42,773 in 2014. Amen. On the average, adjusted age for the annual U.S. suicide rate has increased 24% between 1999 and 2014. I want to tell you right now, there are folks all over the place needing something, amen. And if God, if the people will let the church be the church and let the God of heaven be the God of the church, we can reach those, amen. Amen. And there won't be nearly 45,000, 50,000 people a year killing themselves because they feel like they have no hope.
Right.
I'll tell you this morning, there's a J-shaped vacuum in men and women's hearts, shaped like a J for Jesus.
Amen.
They're trying to fill it with wine bottles. They're trying to fill it with needles. They're trying to fill it with little short straws where they can sniff up a little white powder.
Right.
They're doing everything they can to find comfort and peace and relief. The Isaacs sang that song, "I just need some peace. I need peace." Amen. It talks about the man staring at the liquor bottle. His wife's fixing to leave him because he's an alcoholic. Amen. Staring at the liquor bottle. Amen. Can't get any peace because it's drawing him. Amen. That needle's drawing people. Amen. That next escapade. That next drug deal. That next affair. Amen. Everything. Drawing people, and all they need is Jesus in their hearts. Amen. That'll solve a lot of things.
Amen.
Amen. Looked at the statistics for murder from the Interior Ministry. After seeing 3,881 killings in 2018, the murders reported last year were 21.5 per 100,000 people in 2019. Now in 2018, there were more murders than there were last year. The murder rate calmed down some. That's a great thing. Amen. The police shootings of what some people were saying, I'm liable to get in trouble for this on Facebook because they don't like you if you tell the truth. Amen. But the police shootings for young black men unarmed, supposedly. We know it's not always the case. That's the narrative they were pushing. How many have you heard in 2019? How many police killings, citizens killing police, have you heard? Because that wasn't being pushed by the mainstream media last year and the year before that. Amen. Ever since President Trump come in, he wasn't sitting at the Oval Office or sitting behind that podium with the seal of the United States on it, pushing hate against the police and pushing a racial hatred in the United States of America. That's why we have not seen as big an influx of murders and school shootings and mass shootings as we did in years gone by. About 3.4 million young adults from the age of 18 to 25 had an alcohol disorder in 2017. About 10% of young adults, about 2.5 million young adults had an illicit drug use disorder in 2017. That's just the ones that they knew about. That's not including the ones that have never been to the doctor because of a drug overdose. That's not including the ones that had never spoken to any counselor or anything about it. Come on. About 7.3% of this population, heroin use among young adults between 18 to 25 has doubled in the past decade. Right. Oh, they're trying to find a solution. They're hurrying, they're rushing to try to find something that'll help them. They're trying, and instead of looking for the very thing that would help them, they're looking everywhere else, praise God. Instead of looking to the church, instead of looking to Jesus, amen. And I'll tell you whose fault it is. It's not the mainstream media's fault. It's not, amen, the man out on the street's fault. It's the church's fault. You know why, amen, you ladies and gentlemen, I am the church this morning. And we've said it all, as the home goes, so goes the church. And so as the church goes, so goes the world. And the church has backslid, praise God. We've let down all our standards. There was a time in the old days when those old time Church of God women would walk down the road and you knew what they were and who they were when you saw them. And then they had been in the closet somewhere praying. You could feel the anointing on them. And then walk across, sinners would walk on the other side of the road to keep from passing those women. I tell you what we need to do. Let's get back in our prayer closets one more time, seeking God for a move of God. He said it in 2 Corinthians 7, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray. I was listening to a pastor this morning coming down the road talking about the secret to his prayer life. And he began to talk about, he said, what I did. He said, if you want to be a better musician, he said, you get around a good musician and you watch him, and eventually that'll rub off on you. He said, if you've got a good personality and you want a better personality, get around somebody with a great personality. Amen. And yours, you'll pick up on it and you'll start, amen, copying them. He said there was a pastor up in Cleveland, Tennessee, I believe it was where it was a great man of God, full of faith and full of the Holy Ghost. He called him and told him, said, brother, I want to come and be with you. He said, I never asked people for revival. He said, but I called him and I wanted to go to his place for a revival. He said, and I wanted to be there with him to learn how he prayed. He said at 5 o'clock, 4:30, 5 o'clock, that man got up every morning and come to the church, and he would lay on his face before God for 2 and 3 hours at a time, crying, oh God. Oh, God travailing before the Lord. And he said after a few minutes, you know, he'd begin to talk to God and plead with God. And then he'd go back to travailing some more, oh God. Oh, God. And he said that man had the power of God. And he said after a week of being there, he said it made me hungrier for a walk with God. And he said now, he said I'll pray 2 and 3 hours a day and sometimes more. You know what it takes? It's not going to take us kneeling down. I've seen it, praise God. I have seen it. I've watched it be on the piano playing for the altar call. Somebody go down on one knee and get back up on the other.
A lot better than that.
Yeah. Amen. Get down on one knee and get back. I've seen it.
Yeah. Come on.
And then they wonder why they have trouble with the flesh. Wonder why they have trouble in their spirit. Amen. It's going to take a prayer life in 2020. Amen. Today I'm telling you, it's going to take a prayer life for us to make it in. And if you're not willing to pray, don't you dare think you're not going to God's heaven. Don't you dare think it. Amen. Relationships all over this country hurting. Amen. I'm going to say this. When a couple's married, they can't communicate. That man wants to sit around all the time and do his own thing. And that lovely wife sitting there, amen, and she has no attention from him whatsoever. Amen, it hurts. And just like the same thing with God, when he's standing there, amen, he saved us from sin, brought us out of the mouth of hell, and we can't even talk to him every now and again. We can't even call on him just every, I mean, my God, how much does it take? How to stop scrolling through Facebook for a while? Put your Snapchat down. Put your Instagram and your Twitter up. Amen. Kneel down beside the couch or the bed. Find your closet and empty the bottom of it out. Throw some shoes away if you have to. And get down and talk to God for a little while.
Amen.
My son asked me this morning. He's a backslid preacher. He asked me. He said, Daddy, he said, do you ever just sit and not say anything to God?
Bless you.
Just to see if he'll talk back to you. I heard Brother Bill Houston say one time, great man of God, great man of God. Heard him say when he was dating his wife, he'd call her and talk to her on the phone. And he said every so often he'd just quit talking and listen to her breathe. That's how much he loved her. He'd just listen to her breathe. Just to hear her. That run out of things to say, and he just listened to her breathe. How many times, amen, in our prayer life do we just stop and kneel there or lay before God and listen to him breathe? Listen to what he's got to tell us. Amen. All the, you know, the lot of folks preach about praying and stuff, and we get down to pray and we just tell God what we want God to do. God do this and God do that and God do this and will you do this? We never stop to praise him for it. We never stop to give him the honor and glory to his name. And we especially don't stop to listen to see if he's got anything to say back to us.
Amen.
Amen. I told him, I said, yes, sir. I had to pick him up. That's why I was just a few minutes late this morning. I had to go pick him up from work up in West Union and drive him back to Seneca and then come on here to church. And that's the thing that I was thinking. I told him, I said, yes, sir. I said, sometimes I'll get in there by that couch, wake up 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, can't sleep, things on my mind, people on my mind, and I'll get up and crawl up in the corner of that couch and I'll pray a little while and then I'll just sit there, kneel there, listen to see what God has to say. So many times driving down the road, just turn off the radio, turn off the music and the preaching. Just listen to what God has to say. And I'm telling you, I know God this much. I've got this much confidence in God that he will speak to you.
Amen.
David said, I meditate upon the Lord. What is meditation? It's not yoga. It's not sitting out in a peaceful garden raking sand through a little rake and talking to Buddha and all the rest of them bald-headed fellas. Amen. It's sitting in a place of quiet and thinking about God and thinking about the Word of God. How many times has God showed me something, amen, in the Word of God through meditation and contemplation on him and on his Word? We've got the drug use. We've got suicides. We've got murder. A lot of times murder comes because somebody's angry, wanting to kill somebody else. Sometimes it's because they're wanting to steal something from somebody else so they can go off and do it. I thought about this other thing too. I've got family members right now in this situation. They're not teenagers, but they're you know, younger than 25. But in 2017, the total number of 194,733 babies were born to women aged 15 to 19 years old. Illicit sex. Now, I heard a preacher, and if this gets out to him, he don't know me, I don't know him personally, Kevin Wallace. Kevin's a Church of God preacher, and I'm telling you, every young person, every young married person ought to listen to this video that this man preached. He preached on, I wish I could remember the name of the title of the message, but he preached on had 5,000 young people sitting in an auditorium, sitting Indian style on the floor because they couldn't have the chairs in there, too many of them. But he preached on sexual perversion and how that it is rampant, even in the church among young people. We don't have any young people outside of Brother Josh and myself here and Sister Amanda. That's all young, and Brother Lanier. We don't have that many young people here this morning.
Yeah.
Okay. All of us young people. But anyway, and it happens among us older folks too, I'm going to tell you. But he's talking about we don't preach on sex because it's a no-no. It's a bad word, so to speak. God made it. The devil didn't make it. God made it for marriage and for holy matrimony. He said the bed is undefiled, praise God. And he made it just for that reason. And men have turned it around. The devil has made up things. Pornography is so present in the church world. It's not just something that lawyers and doctors and people like that have to deal with. There's preachers and young assistant pastors and youth pastors, amen, and young people in the churches that are dying because of pornography in the church. Amen. And we've got nearly 200,000 children. That's not including the women that visited Planned Parenthood and got rid of their baby because they didn't want it anymore or because that boyfriend told them, I'll break up with you if you don't abort this baby. Amen. We're living in an age where people need Jesus, where they need a move of God in their lives. And they're not going to find it in a beer bottle. They're not going to find it in a one-night stand with a boyfriend. Amen. They're going to have to find it through me and you doing personal evangelism. Amen. Talking to people, sharing stuff. Amen. To men and women around this nation. It's up to us to let the church be the church. Sin is raging. Sin is that pandemic that is brought upon mankind, that for which there is no cure. But I told you a while ago, from the foundation of the world, God began devising a plan, amen, a cure, a balm, a way of escape. And my words to you are look and live, amen. Amen. When Moses put up that serpent on that pole, it was a type and shadow of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said right there in Matthew, he said, or in John, he said, and if I be lifted up, he was talking about his crucifixion. But I'm telling you this morning, in April of 2020, if we'll lift Jesus up, he said he would draw all men unto him, praise God. I want to tell you, he also made the statement that no man can come to the Father except he draw him. And when Jesus was lifted up on the cross, he began to draw men and women all over this world, amen, to be saved. And if we'll know, if we'll tell them, if we'll share the message to them, look and live. Look at Jesus now and live, amen. He wasn't crucified, I don't think, at ground level. He was crucified up high. And that's what we have to do. We have to lift him up. And we have to tell him from the degradation of sin, from the pit of sin that they're in, look up to Jesus and be saved, praise God. Those fiery serpents represented sin. It represented the devil. It represented everything that hell has to spew forth. Amen. And it couldn't be at ground level. That's where the trash and the filth are. You go to Seneca, South Carolina this morning, and there's trash and filth all over the place. There's houses destroyed down to the ground. Amen. There's trees bigger than men. Brother Lanier can stretch our hands around the trunks of them laying on the side of the road where they were tore up by their roots by this tornado. That's where sin is. Sin's on the ground laying. That's why we have to lift Jesus up. We can't find him in the gutter. They won't find him in their sin. They'll find him from their sin. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Isaiah 45 and 22 said, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is no one else. For I am God, and there is no one else. You know what that tells me? That tells me that old Muhammad, who told us that Allah was the great God. He's a liar. That goes to tell us those fellas that follow that little fat, bald-headed man with the big earlobes that you see in the Chinese restaurant on the counter. That tells me that somebody told a lie. Amen. When you go down there to the grave of Hare Krishna, and when you go down there to the grave of those half-men and half-animal gods that the Hindus worship, it means that somebody told a lie. Amen. Because I am the Lord. I am God, and there is none. Praise God. I began to think about that song. I was in a Baptist children's home when I was about 11 or 12. Mom and Daddy has separated, waiting on a divorce. Daddy couldn't keep us because he was working. Mama was too busy doing her own thing to watch us. Amen. She's saved this morning. She's in a little nursing home down in Seneca. Amen. But she... back then, she was a sight, boy. If I only had time to tell you and wouldn't get in trouble on Facebook because somebody liable to show this video, she liable to beat me to death with one of her canes or a wheelchair or something when I went back to the nursing home. Hey, man, we was in a little children's home, and they would sing this song, you know, every couple of Sundays there, Miracle Heal. Yeah. I have a message from the Lord. Hallelujah. This message unto you I'll give. 'Tis recorded in His word. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live.
Amen.
I ain't gonna try to sing, of course, that thing's real high. But it said, look and live, my brother, live. Look at Jesus now and live. 'Tis recorded in His word. Hallelujah. It is only that you look and live. Praise God. That's what we're going to have to do. That's our message to the lost men and women outside this world. You're being eaten up by the fiery serpents. They're biting you left and right. Amen. And there's no doubt, I don't know if I heard a preacher say this. I don't remember. I couldn't find it in the Bible. But I'm almost persuaded to believe that there, as those Israelites were being bitten, Moses had put that snake up on that pole. I told them, look on the serpent, you'll live. Look on the serpent, you'll live. And there are folks crawling up to that pole. Amen. Bleeding out their legs and arms where the serpents had bit them. Amen. Starting to swell and bust open. And they would look up and God would heal them. But I know, if I know anything, just like the church world today, there were Israelites that refused to look up at that pole, that were being bitten and died in their sin because they refused to look. There's men and women dying in agony, amen, have felt the call of God, have heard the call of God, amen, to look up and live, and they refuse to, and they die in their sin and in their misery. But there are those, I hope this morning, that there's some listening by Facebook, that you'll share this message out and somebody will hear it, that they'll look to Jesus and they will live, and He'll deliver them out of their sin. He'll deliver them out of their misery and out of their agony. Amen. If somebody will come to the piano right quick. Oh, God. Amen. Life is offered unto you. Hallelujah. Eternal life thy soul shall have if you'll only look to Him. Hallelujah. Look to Jesus who alone can save. The writer said, I will tell you how I came, hallelujah, to Jesus when He made me whole. 'Twas believing on His name, hallelujah. I trusted and He saved my soul. Praise God. Woo! I trusted Him and He saved my soul. What a great thought this morning. Oh, I can remember Brother Lanier, I don't know if I told it back here, 2017. One of the worst years of my entire life, praise God. Amen. I went to truck driving school out in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and I half liked it and half didn't like it. It was tough getting up in that big rig and trying to back that thing in a hole. I just could not grasp it until one day it just snapped and I got it. Amen. I thought I had it. But my medical card ran out. I started driving in May. And started driving in March, and my medical card ran out on me, and I got fired because I drove 30 minutes past the time that I was supposed to be at, 12:30. We canceled at 12 o'clock, and I got fired for driving until 12:30. I didn't know. I was ignorant of the situation. I didn't realize how close it was and what I could and couldn't do. But I see where little steps where God brought me, where I'm at right now. I was in Birmingham, Alabama, stranded. They put me out of the truck right there, and all my luggage and my coffee pot and all that stuff on the side of the road. I had a cousin to help me get a hotel room because I didn't have the money and to get the hotel in. The next day, they put me on a bus coming back to Smithfield, North Carolina, where my son and daughter-in-law lives. My sister's boyfriend helped me to get a job down in Georgia driving a truck for a poultry company. And I drove for them for just a few months. But in the meantime, I had backslid. I knew what doing right was. I'd been in church all my life, been in the Holiness Church, except for that little time I was in the Baptist church. But they knew I was Holiness. They knew I was Pentecostal because I'd tell them, you can't believe in that once saved, always saved garbage, and be right with God. Amen. But from June until October of 2017, I was just as backslid as a yard dog. I didn't take up drugs. I didn't take up illicit sex or nothing like that. Smoking and drinking a little bit. But I would drink that stuff and I'd get just as sick as a blue-eyed dog. And you know what I thought? I didn't think this is a good time. I thought, oh, God, Granny's praying for me. Oh, Lord, got a sweet little holiness, Grandma. I've been saved 63 years. Old time holiness. And brother, when she prays, amen, the angels stop what they're doing and say, uh-oh, shh, Granny's praying. Amen. The Lord will answer. He'll answer those prayers. October of 2017, a little sister up in Virginia called me. She said, Eddie, I want to know what's going on. God's put you on my heart. Great woman of God. Been my friend for many years. And there was times, Brother Lanier, that I thought God had left me and God had turned his back on me and I might have been reprobate. But then she called me that night and she said, Eddie, God has put you on my heart. That gave me the greatest hope because I knew God hadn't left me. I knew that there was still hope for this old backslid human being. Amen. And I told her, well, I said, sister, I said, I am backslid. She said, and I told her, I began to talk to her and tell her what all had happened, what all I was going through. And she said, what do you want me to do? And I said, I want you to pray. Pray for me. She said, I'm going to pray. I was under conviction so bad. I was so afraid I was going to die and go to hell. Amen. And didn't know how to get, I knew how to get back. I just didn't know if I could. I didn't know if God would have me back after all those years and the things that I had been through. I didn't know if God wanted me back. She said, I'm going to pray, but I want you to pray. Sitting up in Raleigh, North Carolina.
Praise God.
In a Home Depot parking lot, I prayed and cried my way back through the old time salvation sitting in the front of my little old van.
Amen.
God gave Eddie Hamilton another chance. He's not just the God of a second chance, praise God. He's God of a third. He said, my mercies are made new every morning. Now, I'm going to tell you, there is a time. I may not have another chance if I leave this time. I'm not talking about this time. I'm not going to. But if I leave again, there may not be another chance. His mercy, he may have stopped making a brand new batch of mercy for me that very morning. And my mercy may run out. But I thank God he had mercy on me one more time. Amen. Got down to Grandma's house and through a series of operations and stuff and wound me at my grandmother's house. She told me you could stay with me while the home health care came in and dealt with my foot situation. And we got back to Mount Vernon Holiness Church and listened to Brother Dennis preach and cry with us and pray with us and encourage us to hold on to God. And I got me a little closet in my house and I cleaned out and put a chair in there so I could kneel down and pray. Prayed back through to the Holy Ghost in that little closet. Then Brother Dennis asked me, Brother Eddie, you've been here 2 years, son. I feel like God wants you to preach again. And I started preaching again. Praise God. It's been a great, great time with the Lord for the last 3 years. I appreciate God showing me mercy. I appreciate
God
putting a brazen pole up there for me to look at. And he told me, look and live. My brother live, amen. I looked at that pole and I got saved by his grace and mercy. Amen. He said, I will tell you how glad this morning that you don't have to go home in sin. If you're here this morning and God has not touched your soul and you're not saved, amen, right now Jesus is calling. If you're listening to this video live, amen, Jesus is calling. And if you're listening to it days from now because it's been shared to you and you're not saved, Jesus is calling you. Amen. Everybody that will stand around this place this morning.
Glory to God.
Glory to God. I want us all that will. I know in this little crowd we've got right here, right now, there's people that have not drawn close to God like you need to.